let's start with a short agenda, which topics we would like to discuss today. First of all, I start with an overview about the current status of the HVDC links in Germany, but also, of course, worldwide, which projects are planned. Afterwards, we talk about the requirements to the after installation test. That means which standards and commitments are already available on this topic. And also, as a third point, about the possibilities, the technical possibilities for the AC testing, and also the measurements, how can it be performed? And also, as it is mentioned today already in the secret brochures, what is the monitoring approaches, the first monitoring approaches now for the long HVDC links. And the last point will be our DC testing approach before we start in the discussion and talk about your questions. What is the current status about the HVDC links, starting with Germany? We have three large projects, the SüdLink, SüdOstLink, and A-Nord. All of them are planned with voltage levels of 525 kV and a cable length of 300 to 700 kilometers. It is planned to make the commissioning of those projects within the next years, from 2025 up to 2030. That is the current planning. And let's have a look on a typical structure, how it is discussed at the moment of those HVDC links. Here you see three parts of the total HVDC link. We have DC underground cables and DC overhead lines. Of course, sometimes we also have DC, or very often we have DC subsea cables, which is another topic we will not discuss today. Of course, there are also possibilities to detect the breakdowns on the DC sub cables, but we will concentrate today on the DC underground cable. As mentioned, the maximum cable length or length of the links of the cable links at the moment are planned up to 700 kilometers. And we plan converter station or maximum distances between converter stations and cable transition stations, or between two cable transition stations, of up to 160 kilometers. That is a so-called cable section. That is a maximum length what is taken into consideration. Sometimes it's a little bit less. Yeah, and within such cable sections, of course, we have certain cable parts that are connected with joints. And there are two kinds of joints. We have the straight joints without any earthing connection, and every 12 kilometers, there's a so-called earthing box, where is the connection of to the earthing. So in as a summary, we can say we have with the new, and this is new for the HVDC links, we only have access to earthing links or earthing boxes in long distances, and we talk up to 12 kilometers. There are also some discussions from 8 to 10 or 12 kilometers. It's not completely defined for all projects at the moment. We have certain projects worldwide. Only one possibility or one example is the so-called So Green project in the United States. What is a project in the planning? Also in the planning status at the moment. It will be a route between Mason City and Plano substation, also with a voltage level of 525 kV and a cable length of 560 kilometers. What does now on-site quality assurance for HVDC links mean in a kind of overview? What you see here is the typical life cycle of a cable for manufacturing, installation, operation, and the repair or replacement of cable. Of course, we always have influences from outside. During installation, some defects, or during operation, of course, the aging processes with the operation with DC voltage. Today, we will not talk about manufacturing. This is another topic. We will concentrate on the cable during installation and operation. But the intention is the same. The intention during all stages of the life cycle is to get an assessment of the condition of the cable, and if a fault occurs, to localize this failure. And for that, certain measures are developed or under development or already available. For example, possibilities for the after installation tests, possibilities for the diagnosis or for the monitoring of the cable itself. And the intention with all of this information is to get especially information, localized information about the condition of a cable and of course of all cable components itself. And this is the quality assurance for HVDC links. Let's go a little bit more in detail and talk about about the after installation tests of those cable links. What are the requirements? Would be the first part. This table shows the minimum requirements for the testing of the electrical insulation of the 525 kV cables. And you see there are two approaches. The first approach is the IEC 62895, and there's a national annex NC2 from Germany that concentrates on the 525 kV cables. And it states an AC test with a voltage of 260 kV and a frequency from 10 to 300 Hz with a duration of 1 hour. A PD measurement is recommended during this AC test. And in addition to perform, of course, a DC test as well with a voltage of 0.45 of the nominal voltage with negative polarity and also a duration of 1 hour. Very recently, the SECRE brochure 841 was published from the working group B138. It's just from this month. And it's about the after-laying test on AC and DC cable systems with new technologies. It's like a combination of the current knowledge from manufacturers of cables, operators, and also manufacturers of the test equipment. And it states that due to the AC testing or due to the lack of the experience, the AC test has to be agreed at the end between manufacturer and end user, so there are no complete test values included. But it states, of course, DC testing also with a voltage of 1.45 of the nominal voltage and the duration of 1 hour. And also for PD measurement, it says, okay, it has to be agreed with between manufacturer and end users. What is new is that also the monitoring is mentioned within this publication. We will discuss this a little bit later, what is the reason for that. So as a result out of this table, we can say that the highest level of quality assurance is an AC test in combination with a PD measurement, followed by a DC test. What are the general requirements when we talk with the cable operators? Of course, first point is to execute the test from cable transition station to cable transition station. If you remember, it was the distance of up to 160 kilometers. There are two reasons. First reason is to reduce the test effort itself. That means not to have too many test stations. And of course, in addition, to test all cable joints, because only on the cable transition stations, it's possible to make a connection without opening the cable itself. Second point is we have to consider the maximal current carrying capacity of the cable shield. I will discuss this topic a little bit later, what it means and what is the main topic behind it. And the third point, of course, to apply a sensitive PD measurements that allow a special allocation of the PD sources. And of course, there are lots of measurement devices available for PD, but it has to be the structure of the cable system has to be considered. And what are the possibilities for that will also be discussed on the next slides. Let's talk about AC testing, measurements, and the monitoring. The first approach for the AC testing, what we will discuss today, is the testing with resonant circuit. On the left side, you see the basic series resonant circuit consisting of an inductance, capacitance, and of course, a resistance. And due to frequency, power supply with a variable frequency, it's possible to reach the resonance condition and to get the test voltage out of that. That's the main, the basic idea behind it. On the right side, you see the components of such a test circuit. Of course, first of all, what is needed is a frequency converter converting, for example, an AC, a three-phase AC power supply to an AC power supply with a variable frequency between 10 and 300 hertz. Then we have the erection transformer, exciting transformer with certain taps that can be adapted to the cable. We have the reactors, but we will show you that are the resonant reactors with a fixed inductance, the voltage divider, with for the voltage measurements, and of course the load capacitance, what is at the end the cable system, as the high voltage cables are typically in capacitance. When we now design a test system, certain parameters have to be considered. First of all, the test voltage level. As mentioned before, it is not completely clear defined if 260 kV or 394 kV should be considered. The IEC with the German amendment to the IEC says 260 kV, but there are also operators that insist of 394 kV. Second point is the load capacitance. Of course, this depends on the cable design. For first assumption, we can assume a cable capacity of 0.24 microfarad per kilometers, but of course this depends on the cable design. Then we have to define the test frequency, especially the minimum test frequency. If 10. Ten halves can be agreed. Could you just mute your microphone? Ah, thank you very much. Okay, and then we have the test cycle. Normally, we have a test cycle of 1 hour. And so with the assumption that we normally use for the design of the reactors, we assume 1 hour on, 1 hour off of the reactors and three times per day. So we have a modular design. The modular design of the reactors allow a parallel and series connection of several reactors. And due to that, certain and different design parameters of the complete cable system can be realized and are possible to fulfill different requirements to the test circuits. What you see on the right side is firstly a standard reactor that is already used for cable testing at the moment. You see 260 kV, 30 MVA. This is what we realized, for example, many times worldwide. And on the right side, the XXL reactor, this is a new design with 120 MVA. That means four times the power, also 260 kV. But of course, space saving. It has a space saving design in comparison to the standard reactors here. What are the challenges for testing long single core cables? This is what I mentioned before. Generally, of course, what is clear, if we have an HVDC cable and we feed it from one side, and that means we feed the test current from one side, the current through the cable shield is equal to the current through the conductor. This is sure. The challenge now is that in comparison to the cross-section of the conductor, the cross-section of the cable shield is normally much smaller. So we assume, or very often, especially for underground land cables, we assume only 10% of the conductor. That means we have a much smaller cross-section of the shield. And based on this design, of this specific cable design, of course, we have to adapt also the test circuit. We have to use or choose a suitable test circuit that fulfills the cross-section or that adapts the test circuit to the cross-section of the cable shield. What are the possibilities for that? I would like to explain three parts of it, three factors that influence the current through this cable shield. First of all, the test frequency. if the test frequency is reduced from 20 to 10 hearts, the current is also reduced by 50%. The second possibility is a double side feeding. That means the reactors are connected on the left and also on the right side of the cable. That means on the cable end and the cable beginning. And due to that, another reduction of maximum 50% is possible. And only due to these two possibilities, it is possible to reduce the current through the cable shield by approximately 75%. And what is possible out of that, of course, is a reduction of the cable losses of up to 93%. Another possibility, what we see here, is the parallel cable. So we can use a second pole of the cable system as return conductor. Here you see the shielding is connected to the second pole, and of course, depending on the cable design, it will be reduced. I would like to show you two possibilities for such a system so that you get an imagine about the practical realization of a test system for the commissioning test. Configuration one is has a test voltage of 260 kV. We assume a test frequency of 12 hertz and a test duration of 1 hour. In this situation, we would need seven reactors, as I showed you before, seven XXL reactors in parallel. And then we would need a power supply from a staff grid of 1.4 MVA. Additionally, optionally, it would be also possible to use diesel generators. In this case, of course, the power supply would be, or we would need a larger power supply in order to get a proper supply of the test reactors. And if we now have a look on the test current and the current through the cable shield, we see that the cable current through the cable shield has 460 amps in a maximum. And of course, this is done due to the double side feeding. The total test current would be 790 amps. The second configuration with 394 kV is just for comparison, also calculated for 12 hearts and a test duration of 1 hour. In this case, we would need 16 reactors. Two times eight reactors in parallel. And in this case, we would require a power supply of 3.2 MVA. The test current or the current through the cable shield would be 585 amps and the total test current 1170 amps. In order to get an impression about the test system itself, I would like to show you a short movie that also shows the configuration on site of such a system. Okay.
Maybe as moderator, I can jump in here. There was one slight update. It's what we have seen was at the time when the video was taken, the most powerful system. Last year, we have delivered to Nexans US a bigger test system. It was very successfully taken into operation November, December 2020.
Okay. Let's talk about the measurement requirements. First of all, we need a sensitive PD evaluation for each cable joint. That means also for the straight joints during the AC test. Secondly, of course, if a failure occurs, we need a fault localization of potential cable breakdowns, also during the AC test. And of course, the third point is a minimal effort for the system integration due to the consideration of the structure of the cable system. Now we have a challenge. If we think about the conventional PD evaluation, as we know it from the current state of the art, of course we always determine the apparent charge that is recorded at a certain measuring point, and of course not at the location of the fault. What results out of this procedure is, in order to make a good localization, we need a lot of measuring points. Or some statistic methods are also available for that, but at the end we always need a lot of measuring points. What is not suitable for the HVDC links that are planned at the moment? The solution, or a possible solution out of that, would be another method that does not localize, or that does not measure the integral apparent charge at a certain measuring point, but that determines the effective charge at the location of the fault. And I will explain you a method that is called true PD that would fulfill such a requirement and would also be suitable for long HVDC cables. Such true PD method is a combination, or is a result of the combination of the cooperation of a lot of universities and also industrial partners. So like the Technical University, the University of Zittau and Görlitz, the University of Cottbus, and also from Würzburg Schweinfurt. RITS as manufacturer as a partner for possible sensors, MR with the experience of the cable operators, and of course also with NKT as a manufacturer or as a cable manufacturer itself. What I can recommend if you are interested is a web talk from the beginning of this year. You can find it. In the internet, and we will also put the link in the chat now. There was a discussion with Mark Geronzi, Professor Zink, and Eric Winkelmann, who is our project manager for this for the new development in HiVolt. And there was like a discussion about the cable monitoring on long DC cables and the experiences. And the current experiences of the three experts here. I will discuss and will show you the first approach, the function of TrueBD, of the TrueBD method, and also the possibilities of the practical realization. What is the method of TrueBD? You see, it is divided in two steps. Step A is an analysis and synthesis of all cable sections. Here you see a typical cable section with a length of 2 to 12 kilometers. And you see there's a connection of a sensor, an HFCT sensor, and digitalization unit on both sides of this cable section itself. The digitalization units are connected with a normal communication, Ethernet communication, for example, just for data exchange. What is done in the first step is a signal is injected into the cable from the one side, and on the other side it is recorded. And out of the measured result, it is possible to determine the transfer function of the cable section. And this cable or this information is used in the next step, this measurement and the filtering of the relay signals. If now a certain partial discharge occurs in the insulation, of course it can be measured from both measuring points. And what we can use, or what we can do, is we use the transfer function and can calculate the level of the detected partial discharge at the location of the fault. And afterwards we can make a classification and a characterization with certain algorithms in order to understand what is the reason for a certain partial discharge. This is a method, the first beginning method of true PD. What is the practical realization? What you see here are two mock-ups of the main components. On the left side, you see the HFCT sensor, HiMac. It has a nominal current up to 3000 amps for the HVDC projects. It is suitable. Then we have the low effect, of course, on the we need a low effect on the cable system. Therefore, it has a very low inductance of less than 0.2 microhenry. And what you cannot see here at the moment, but I will show you pictures at the end of the presentation, it has also a split core, so it can be connected to the cable system or to the conductor and the shield after installation of the cable itself. On the right side, you see the digitalization unit. We call it high-res TrueBD with 250 megasamples per second and 16-bit. And of course, there is installed already the algorithms to detect the small signals, also to detect the signals in a noise. And what is one challenge, and what is always under discussion, is how to make the power supply of such a digitalization unit, because now we have every 12 kilometers we would need such an unit, and the power supply can be done. Of course, with a staff grid, what is normally not available, but can be used. What could also be used is our solar panels, or what is under evaluation and development at the moment is to use an energy harvesting using the ripple from the DC cable. What is the possible, or how can this method be used practically for a cable that should be tested and a cable that is in operation? So we have three steps of the evaluation and of the usage of this true PD method. First of all, is a measurement after installation. Of course, we have to localize and evaluate the defects during the AC test after the installation. In this case, the HiMac, that means the HFCT sensors, and also the high-res have to be installed temporarily and can be used for certain cable sections. A second possibility is when the cable is under operation, we can realize trend analysis due to a regular fingerprint measurements during the operation of the cable. In this case, the HiMac should be installed permanently, and the high-res can be just put to the sensors temporarily in order to get some trends in a certain time. And the third possibility, or third step, with the highest output for the operator itself, is a possible monitoring. In this case, we make a classification of events and a predictive evaluation of the cable due to this continuous evaluation of this cable. In this case, of course, the sensors and also the digitalization units, high-res, have to be installed permanently. I will show you one first pilot project to get an idea how it looks in practice. Here you see it's a connection of a subsea cable to a land cable, and the land cable section has a length of 14 kilometers. It's a DC underground cable, 400 kV. And we made at the beginning an one side connection that close to the converter station. We have the sensor here and the connection to the digitalization unit that is installed in an outdoor cabinet and is connected with the LTE connection to a database. And here you get some impressions how it looks. First picture shows the HiMix sensor. Here you see that it is a split core. You also see that it is around the cable and the cable shield, and then the earthing itself here. And we have the on the right side, or in the middle, you see an additional sensor we put for development purposes only around the earthing here. And you see an additional HiMix connected through the complete cable. And this is a normal cable tower where the cable comes from Earth and goes to the converter station. And on the right side is for the field test, the outdoor cabinet that includes certain digitalization units, of course, some control and measuring equipment. And in addition, also what you see here, the high-res locator in order to detect possible cable breakdowns additionally. Let's come to the last point of this discussion or this webinar about the DC testing. If you remember, we need a DC voltage of 761 kV, and for that, how to realize this test voltage is in order to use a modular 800 kV DC test system, for example. On the right side, you see the system installed in our own test field in Dresden here. We have two DC modules connected in series to each other. We have the combination to a support element. Additionally, this is optionally in this case, and an additional discharge unit. And I will show you the reason for that on the next slide. And we have on the right side, just another picture that shows such an 800 kV test system in outdoor usage at the end, and with additional transport and storage containers for the mobile use. Now, what is now the influence on the overstress of a HVDC cable? I will show you two schematic charts that explain different approaches for the test system itself. So on the left side, it's like the typical or the easiest way for the DC test. You see, we have to reach a certain test voltage we have to charge the DC cable to a certain test voltage in order to start the one hour DC test. And of course, after reaching the nominal voltage up to the test voltage, there starts an overstress for the cable. Then we have the 1 hour test, and afterwards we have a discharge of the cable. And if we do not apply any additional components, there will be, of course, an additional discharge or an additional overstress of the cable up to the nominal voltage of the cable itself. In order to reduce such overstress of the cables, what can be done is to make a connection of four DC modules. That in this case, we have two modules in series and two in parallel. Of course, this reduces the charging time and in this kind also the overstress of the cable itself. And the normal test voltage is 1 hour again. And the second possibility is to adapt a discharging unit, and this discharging unit of course, also results, or as a result of this discharge unit, the overstress up to the discharge of the cable itself is reduced as well. So, as a summary of this very schematic, I will give you some numbers afterwards. As a summary of this slide, it can be said that the reduction of the overstress of the HVDC cables can be done due to a configuration with four DC modules and with an additional discharge unit. What is a possible configuration for as a summary out of that for the DC testing? The test voltage, as mentioned, is 761 kV, the test duration 1 hour, and we have a configuration of four DC modules. That means two modules in series and two in parallel. The discharge unit should be included, and in this case, we have a charging current of 60 milliamps, and we require a power supply of 120 kVA. What does it mean? For charging, to get an idea about the charging and discharging times, if we assume a cable capacity of 0.24 microfarad per kilometer and a conductance of 50 picosiemens per kilometer and the test voltage of 761 kV, for a cable length of 600 kilometers, we have a charging time of 1.5 hours and a discharging time without the discharging unit of 9 hours, which would be the normal discharging, and a discharging time with a discharging unit of 55 minutes. On the left side, you see a short, small diagram explaining the maximum testable cable length independent of the conductance of the insulation. And you see if you have the in conductance of 50 picocoulombs, the cable length of up to 800 kilometers can be tested very easily. So this is the end of the webinar input. And now we are open for your discussions and your questions. Just a short information. If you would like to keep updated and to get innovation insights, press release and event information, you can visit our website, also LinkedIn. You can also follow us on YouTube. Or of course, if you have any questions, you can also direct mail me to my email address, what you see here, and ask any questions. We are open for you. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Dan. I have collected several questions during your session. I try to share the screen. Now the question is, what will be the right screen? That should be the screen. And can I get a feedback if you can see the Q&A section?
Can you see my screen?
Perfect. So I will try to go through the questions here. The most important question at the beginning, will the presentation available for the participants? For sure, we will give you access to the presentation material afterwards. That will also include then the recording. The presentation as such will be available as soon as possible. I will not say in minutes or hours, but definitely today, latest tomorrow. For the video, we will do some reductions and cuts so that it still stays then interesting. That might take one or two days longer. So there means this is the question already answered. Then I think we should start with the questions related to the cables, and that was a question which comes then also from our colleagues from Prismon. Simone Manfredi was asking three times per day. What is the meaning of that? It's possible to test three cables per day, including switch from one to another. Dan, you want to take up the question?
Can you hear me now? Yes. Okay. I was muted. Sorry for that. Yes. What can we three times per day means the design of the reactor is that it is possible to make a 100% test. That means the full power of the test system three times for 1 hour. What does it mean practically for you? At the end, you can test maximum three single core cables per day from the reactor design itself. At the end, it comes from the DC cables. I think it will be more practical to test two cables, for example, per day, as you have a plus and minus pole, for example.
Yeah. So
at full power, yes. Yeah. Alexander, at full power, of course.
I think the latest question is then coming up at the far end. Is it also applicable to cable system at lower voltages? I think that's also something easily to be answered.
Of course, yeah. The test system allows a maximum voltage of 260 kilovolt now, and of course the voltage can be adapted for smaller voltages as well.
Yeah. So, and if it saves the cable testing,
I think I'm there. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Yep. I see the screen now. Okay. Good.
Okay.
Yes, I'm on.
Then we should stay with the questions on cable AC testing. Do you also offer an VLF system that should be smaller? There the answer will be twofold. The first question, first answer will be no. We do not offer a VLF system. That should be smaller. Yes, that might be smaller. The much more important question is VLF a suitable test voltage to be applied on this kind of cables? And this is not a medium voltage cable, and if you're discussing here, then high voltage cables, the VLF is definitely not the right technology to test such cables. So, you want to add something?
Yeah. In addition, what is also the outcome of the secret, the actual secret brochure? What I mentioned is also that it is recommended to use a test frequency that is close to the power frequency. That means 250 hertz.
Yeah. So then there was a question which I would like to combine with another one, saying here, what is the typical limitation of the length of cable to be tested with an AC resonant test circuit? And I would like to combine that with the question, what is the maximum length of HVDC cables do you think could be tested or has been tested?
Correct, yeah. What is the limitation? The limitation of testing of the cables is at the end always connected to the cable design, and that means it is connected to the cable shield. As I said, we have to take into account that the cable shield has to carry a certain test current, and according to this design of the cable shield at the end, we have to calculate what is the maximum possible cable length. So for the German projects, for example, we talk about the cable length, what is like a result of those discussions of 160 kilometers. And this is what is possible to test at the moment. But the limitation is not done by the test reactors. So as it is a modular design, we could also implement or make a parallel connection of further reactors itself. The limitation at the end is done by the cable design itself.
I have a question which I see on my one screen, but not on the moderator screen, but not on the monitor screen. That was, can you cascade the XXL reactors, so the large reactors we have seen also in the video, and I think the video has already shown yes, we can connect them as well in series as well as in parallel. And this is also done for the different applications we have installed worldwide meanwhile. Mm-hmm. We have here the questions regarding the cross-section of the cable shield. So what is the recommendation for the cross-section of the cable shield?
I think this is connected also to the question before about the maximum cable length. Yeah, what is the recommendation for the cross section? At the end, we just can say please take into account the test from the very beginning of a cable design. That means if you have a smaller cable length to be tested, of course the cable shield could have a smaller cross section. If you would like to test a longer cable section, if you would like to test a longer section length of a cable, that means up to 160 or even longer cables, we recommend, it's not a recommendation, you would need a larger cross section of the cable at the end.
Finally, what we have to say there is it's something which is related to the cable design as such. And our recommendation in the end is that for the overall cable system project, the question of testing has to be taken into consideration before the cable design is finalized. So otherwise, it might end up in some issues for designing or defining the right test circuit. Another topic, I think, which can be answered also very quickly for the feeding of the test system, there was mentioned by you a sufficient size if you want to go to diesel gensets. So what is the meaning of sufficient? I think there we also have a very clear answer to it.
Yeah, the clear answer is a double size of the staff grid as a rough idea.
Okay, so to my understanding, we have more or less all topics covered on the AC resonant testing. Now let's go into the discussions we had on, or the questions we had on the PD monitoring. Mm-hmm. So I think the first question which can be seen there is, for the long distances between the sensors, so we have talked about 12 kilometers, isn't signal damping becoming an issue?
Yeah, of course. And that's a good, very good question. Of course, also a clear question. If we talk about a cable length of 12 kilometers, the damping is definitely a topic. And this is like the part of our development of the last years. How to evaluate signals in noise, and this is what we did, for example, with possibilities with certain signal approaches together with the Technical University of Dresden. And yes, it is a topic, and it's a topic that was solved in our field. If you need further information about it, how we do it, just send me an email, and we can make. We can send you or give you additional information about that.
Yeah, there's some scientific publication on it where it's described how that work, and I think Dan can provide that as well. Having answered that, then we also have already answered the question by David Clark. Mm-hmm. So based on the technology we have in place, we see for a typical cable design and maximum distance between the sensors of 12 kilometers. Another question from David was, what sort of bandwidth does the HFCT sensor have?
Uwe, I think something for you because it's your product.
Yeah. It's not my product, so I'm responsible to do some work on the industrialization. The bandwidth is it's a wide bandwidth system here, and we have designed the HFCT in such a way that it fits also then to a wide range of cables, and The design is also one of the topics where we would like to have our hands on there as well. Taking up the next question for the HiMec as well, I will also try to answer it. the pictures we have seen have shown that the device is fairly heavy, so or big as well. So it will be in the range of 25 to 28 kilograms. So that means you would need definitely a kind of support structure to install it. So we have a split core there so that it can be then also assembled around the cable, also of an on an existing cable. So there is also then a question of the physics behind there. As we have there some special swords, how we can handle them also our bandwidth and frequency range in the right manner with the sufficient designed our inner core there, and therefore we also have then always to put there some material inside the core. Another question which goes down more to you. For TruePD, do you have already qualified results from the field?
Yeah, we started with first measurements in our own test fields some time ago. So that was the first results that we have. Second point was we have a demonstration cable and installed in Dresden to get information out of that. And of course, we have real DC tests now on a 400 kV DC cable, and our installation of an 110 kV AC cable. So that means out of that, we already get first results. This is not something where we would say we are completely finished with the development out of that, but we already have results from the even from cables in operation.
Yeah, when we stay with TruePD, how will data mining be used for the TruePD testing? Should I take that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Uwe, you can answer.
Yeah, so data mining, that's always the question, what's behind there. So if we want to use the buzzwords big data, then maybe there will be not real big data. So for us, it's much more important to identify the partial discharge and to collect them. And therefore, we utilizing our their technology where we concentrate on the effective, real effective impulses to be measured and evaluated, and based on that are also then are to have their a methodology to calculate back on the effective discharge and the location where the discharge happened. That means to me that we are doing the data mining in the incoming data stream, which comes from the measurement system, and then we reduce as close as possible to the object under test or monitoring, then to reduce it to the relevant information, so that we then can also reduce or that we can get rid of all the data which are not really necessary to describe the specific phenomena, so that we really can have there a concentration on the usable data. For me, data mining very early in the process, when we're discussing how do we evaluate then the results, there will be AI and data mining technologies play also a role by comparing results and to transfer also results then to other measurements, so that based on that, yes, we will have there a kind of big data AI approach on two different steps. The first thing is, first, we want to get the effective measurement data, and in the second step, we want also to have the capability to do the correct analysis and evaluation of the data. So, now, when we stay with I see here another incoming question, which also is related to that topic. How do you synchronize pulses arriving at the distributed sensors? Anytime synchronization pulse? There, the clear answer is no, there is no time synchronization necessary. And the approach, what we have already shown, also in the presentation, gives the answer. So we always have there an effective reference to the transfer function of the supervised or monitored cable segment, and that is the right approach to evaluate the data there. Okay, now we have left there some four questions in the list here. So when we stay with the PD measurements, then there is a question referring to the testing of submarine cables. What's the cable length limitation to measure PD? Yeah, there the simple answer is there isn't a difference between the land cables and the submarine cables. So we have there the effective damping function of the cable, and that means cable design will have an impact also to the effective length. So that what we can see in the moment is for the land cables the 12 kilometers, so that can be extended most probably also then for the submarine cables, as we don't have impedance differences along the cables on the joints. So that could be more. What's clear, if you have several hundred kilometers, you will not be able, of a submarine cable, you will not be able with a single sensor to have there the PD measurement, an electrical PD measurement along the complete cable length so far. That was this question. The four DC modules, how are they connected? Two series, two parallel? Related to your
present. Yeah, it can be answered clearly. So we have two in series to reach the 800 kV, and two in parallel to reach, instead of 30 milliamps, 60 milliamps charging current.
So I think I have received one question. One important topic which very often comes up in the discussion about the AC test, isn't there a risk to apply an AC current to a cable system that has already seen HVDC? I think the meaning was to apply an AC voltage to the cable system. From a pure technological point of view, applying it to the cable, that's already proven that this is not a problem. Applying it to a cable with terminations and joints, it depends. There are definitely systems which are extruded systems which are capable to be applied with an AC voltage after DC stressing. There are also joints which might see there an issue due to their design and the used materials. So a clear yes or no is there not possible? That's still something what has to be investigated. The major reason to apply an AC test voltage is the afterlaying qualification of the cable, so that you can clearly identify in the first step the potential failures which might happen during the installation of the joints. That's the priority. Nevertheless, from our perspective, it's also important to have there also very clear answers then what happens during maintenance and after repair. What happens then if you apply an AC voltage? As already mentioned, it's proven that the cable as such is there definitely not an issue. And for the accessories, there are still certain investigations ongoing. Okay, now this is a question to you, Dan. Permanent installation of monitoring equipment. What's the lifetime of your electronics and how can you guarantee 24/7 and hopefully over 50 years?
Yeah, first part of this question was the lifetime of the components. If we talk about the HFCT sensor, it is designed for the complete lifetime of the cable, also for an underground installation of these HFCTs. Of course, the electronics will have a normal lifetime as we assume it from electronics, so that means 10 to 15 years. What do we do for a 24/7 operation? First of all, the equipment is included in an or has included a self-diagnostic system that gives information about the status and the health of the measuring system itself. And in addition, of course, critical parts have a certain kind of redundancy, so that allows the permanent work of the systems.
Okay. So there are still incoming questions. One of them is the calculation to get the real discharge of the pulse in case of true PD. Yeah. Is it done in the high res? I think that it's a little bit related to the showcase you have shown.
Mm-hmm. Also the calculation itself. So the question is if it is done in the cloud or in the, on the system itself. So that means the localization of a certain pulse. It's part of the clustering and localization of the pulses. And this is done in the high res or in the devices itself.
Okay, then there was a question related to the transfer function. Mm-hmm. So you calculate the transfer function for each cable installation, since I guess this would vary a lot depending on cross section and cable type.
Okay, Uwe, will you answer?
Yeah, I can take it. So it's very clear. Yes, it will depend on cross-section cable type. And it's also clear that along a cable installation or a cable system, you might have also different cross-sections and maybe also cable types. Therefore, it's also a very clear answer from our side. Yes, we calculate the transfer function for the cable installation. And yes, we do even more. So we calculate the transfer function for each supervised or monitored segment. This is then the transfer, as we said, so maximum of 12 kilometers. So we will have then for each segment of the cable, then also the specific transfer function then I calculated and always hold assured that we have it then also as a function of the environmental conditions. Anything to add from your side? It doesn't sound like that. I got another question. So you calculate back amplitude and position of the original discharge. Yeah,
correct. This is correct. That's what we do.
Okay. I'm through with all the questions I have here on the Q&A.
Yeah. So thank you very much for your attendance in this webinar. I hope that it was interesting for you. If you have any questions, please do not hesitate to contact us by mail or by phone. So we are open for your questions on this topic. And yeah, as we understood, if we have further development, we will keep you updated, and we can make an invitation for further webinar in the future as well, of course. Thank you very much.